Your son can wait. I'm the one who matters here, Hannah. Prioritize me or leave. Eli's words sliced through the air, sharp and cold. I stood frozen, my hands still on Caleb's feverish forehead. Our four-year-old whimpered, his small body shivering under the blanket. He's burning up, Eli. We need to take him to the hospital, I pleaded, my voice barely above a whisper. Eli loosened his tie, his eyes fixed on his reflection in the hallway mirror. I have a crucial meeting in an hour. You can handle this yourself. My name is Hannah, and this was the moment I realized my marriage was beyond saving. I scooped Caleb into my arms, his heat seeping through my thin blouse. I'm taking him to the ER. Don't wait up. Eli's hand clamped around my wrist as I reached for the car keys. You're not going anywhere. What will people think if they see you out this late, looking like that? I yanked my arm free, anger rising in my chest. Like what, Eli? Like a mother caring for her sick child. His nostrils flared. Like a woman who can't keep her house in order. It reflects poorly on me. Mommy, Caleb whimpered, burying his face in my neck. I grabbed the keys and headed for the door. Eli's voice followed me, a low, menacing growl. If you leave now, don't bother coming back. The cool night air hit my face as I stepped outside, Caleb clinging to me like a lifeline. I buckled him into his car seat, my hands shaking. As I pulled out of the driveway, I caught a glimpse of Eli in the window, his face a mask of indifference. How had we come to this? The charming man I'd fallen in love with seemed like a distant memory, replaced by this cold, uncaring stranger. The hospital waiting room was a blur of fluorescent lights and worried faces. I filled out forms on autopilot, my mind racing. How long had I been ignoring the signs? The subtle put-downs, the constant criticism, the way he'd slowly isolated me from friends and family. Mrs. Walker. A nurse called my name, jolting me back to reality. We're ready to see Caleb now. As the doctor examined my son, I made a silent vow. This ends now. No more excuses, no more second chances. Caleb deserves better. I deserve better. My phone buzzed with a text from Eli. I expect dinner when I get home. Don't disappoint me again. I stared at the screen, a strange calm settling over me. For the first time in years, I saw our relationship with crystal clarity. This wasn't love. It was control, manipulation, and fear. Your son has a severe ear infection, the doctor explained, writing out a prescription. He'll need antibiotics and plenty of rest. I nodded, cradling Caleb close. Thank you, doctor. We'll follow your instructions carefully. As we left the hospital, the first rays of dawn were breaking over the horizon. A new day, a new beginning. I kissed Caleb's forehead, now cooler to the touch. Where are we going, Mommy? He asked sleepily. I smiled, a plan already forming in my mind. We're going on an adventure, sweetheart. Just you and me. I pulled out my phone and dialed a number I hadn't used in far too long. Mom, it's Hannah. I need your help. As I drove towards my parents' house, I felt a weight lifting from my shoulders. The road ahead would be difficult, but for the first time in years, I felt hope. Eli had underestimated me for the last time. Now it was my turn to show him exactly what I was capable of. The morning sun filtered through the curtains as I sat at my parents' kitchen table, nursing a cup of coffee. Caleb's soft snores drifted from the guest room where he slept peacefully, his fever finally broken. Mom bustled around, making breakfast, while Dad read the newspaper, occasionally glancing at me with concern. Hannah, sweetheart, Mom said, setting a plate of eggs in front of me. You need to eat something. I nodded, forcing myself to take a bite. The events of the past few days swirled in my mind, a chaotic blend of fear, anger, and an unexpected sense of liberation. Have you heard from Eli? Dad asked, his voice gruff with barely concealed anger. I shook my head. No, and I don't want to. I've blocked his number. Mom sat beside me, her hand warm on my arm. You did the right thing, Hannah. No one deserves to be treated that way. As I looked at my parents, I felt a pang of regret for the years I'd spent distancing myself from them, all to please Eli. How had I let it come to this? I remembered the day I met Eli, his charm and confidence sweeping me off my feet. He'd seemed so different then, attentive and caring. But looking back, I could see the warning signs I'd ignored, the possessiveness masked as protectiveness, the subtle put-downs disguised as jokes. "I feel so stupid," I whispered, tears stinging my eyes. "How did I not see it sooner?" Dad set down his paper, his eyes softening. "You're not stupid, Hannah. Men like Eli are experts at manipulation. What matters is that you've seen the truth now." A knock at the door made us all jump. Mom went to answer it, returning with the worried expression. "It's Abigail, Eli's sister." My heart raced as Abigail entered the kitchen. Her eyes were red-rimmed, her usually impeccable appearance disheveled. "Hannah," she said, her voice trembling. "I'm so sorry. I had no idea things were so bad." I stiffened, unsure of her motives. "What are you doing here, Abigail?" She sat down heavily, wringing her hands. "Eli called me last night, ranting about how you'd kidnapped Caleb. I came to talk some sense into you, but—" She trailed off, looking around the kitchen. I see now that I'm the one who needed sense talked into me. As Abigail spoke, the full weight of my situation hit me. I was a stay-at-home mom with no income of my own. Eli controlled our finances, and I had no access to our joint accounts. The realization left me breathless with panic. "What am I going to do?" I whispered, more to myself than anyone else. Dad leaned forward, his jaw set with determination. "You're going to fight, Hannah. We'll help you get a lawyer, figure out your finances. Eli won't get away with this." Abigail nodded, a spark of determination in her eyes. "I'll help too. I know things about Eli's business dealings that could be useful." For the first time in days, I felt a glimmer of hope. I wasn't alone in this fight. As we talked, planning our next steps, I heard Caleb calling for me. I excused myself and went to him, gathering him in my arms. "Mommy, where's Daddy?" he asked, his big eyes full of confusion. I took a deep breath, choosing my words carefully. "Daddy and Mommy need some time apart, sweetheart. But I promise you, everything's going to be okay." As I held my son, I made a silent vow. I would build a new life for us, one free from Eli's toxic influence. It wouldn't be easy, but with my family's support and my newfound resolve, I knew we could do it. Returning to the kitchen with Caleb, I saw my parents and Abigail deep in discussion. They looked up as we entered, their faces softening at the sight of Caleb. "Ready for some breakfast, champ?" Dad asked, his voice warm. As Caleb nodded eagerly, I felt a surge of determination. This was just the beginning of our journey, but for the first time in years, I was excited about what the future might hold. The next few days passed in a blur of hushed conversations and furtive planning. I felt like a spy in my own life, carefully gathering essentials and important documents while Eli was at work. Each night, I'd lie awake, my heart racing at every creak of the house, terrified he'd discover my intentions. One afternoon, while Eli was at a crucial meeting, I seized the opportunity to call my parents. "Mom," answered on the second ring. "Hannah, is everything all right?" I took a deep breath, steadying myself. "Mom, I need your help. I'm leaving Eli, and I need a place for Caleb and me to stay." There was a moment of silence, then Mom's voice came back, strong and sure. "Of course, sweetheart. You come here right away. We'll figure everything out together." Relief washed over me, followed quickly by a wave of guilt. "I'm so sorry I've kept you at arm's length all these years." "Eli, sure," Mom soothed. "None of that matters now. We're here for you, always have been." As I hung up, I heard the front door open. Panic seized me as Eli's footsteps echoed through the house. "Hannah," he called, his voice sharp. "Where are you?" I quickly composed myself and stepped into the hallway. "In here. You're home early." Eli's eyes narrowed. "The meeting was canceled. Who were you talking to?" "Just making a grocery list." I lied smoothly, surprised at how easily the deception came. "Caleb needs more of that cereal he likes." Eli grunted, seemingly satisfied. "Make sure you pick up my dry cleaning while you're out. And don't forget, we have dinner with the Johnsons tomorrow night. Wear that blue dress I bought you." I nodded meekly, all the while my mind racing with plans. Tomorrow night would be perfect. While Eli was schmoozing with his colleagues, I could make our escape. The next evening, I dressed carefully in the blue dress Eli favored, my overnight bag already packed and hidden in the trunk of my car. As we drove to the restaurant, Eli droned on about his latest business deal, oblivious to the turmoil inside me. At the restaurant, I excused myself to the restroom, my hands shaking as I dialed my dad's number. "We're ready," I whispered. "Can you meet us at the house in an hour?" Dad's voice was gruff with emotion. "We'll be there, Hannah. Stay strong." Returning to the table, I plastered on a smile and nodded along to the conversation. Inside, I was counting down the minutes. An hour later, I feigned a migraine, insisting Eli stay and entertain his guests while I went home to rest. He barely spared me a glance as I left, too engrossed in impressing his colleagues. As I pulled into our driveway, I saw my parents' car already waiting. Mom rushed to embrace me as I stepped out. "Oh, Hannah," she murmured, holding me tight. Dad was already inside, scooping a sleepy Caleb into his arms. "Let's go, sweetheart. We don't have much time." We worked quickly, loading the car with the bags I'd packed and a few of Caleb's favorite toys. As we were about to leave, I hesitated in the doorway, looking back at the house that had been my prison for so long. "Hannah," Dad said gently, "it's time to go." With a deep breath, I nodded and closed the door behind me, symbolically closing this chapter of my life. As we drove away, Caleb stirred in the back seat. "Mommy, where are we going?" I reached back to squeeze his hand. "We're going on an adventure, sweetie. Everything's going to be okay now." Looking in the rearview mirror, I saw my parents' car following close behind, a physical representation of the support I denied myself for too long. For the first time in years, I felt a glimmer of hope for the future. As we turned onto the highway, leaving our old life behind, I felt a weight lift from my shoulders. The road ahead was uncertain, but I knew with unwavering certainty that it led to a better life for Caleb and me. The first rays of sunlight crept through the curtains of my childhood bedroom, now a sanctuary for Caleb and me. It had been a week since our escape, and each morning I woke with a mixture of relief and anxiety. Today, however, a new emotion stirred within me: determination. I tiptoed past Caleb's sleeping form and made my way to the kitchen, where Mom was already brewing coffee. "Morning, sweetheart," she said, sliding a mug towards me. "Sleep well?" I nodded, wrapping my hands around the warm ceramic. "I think it's time I started looking for a job." Mom's eyebrows shot up. "Are you sure?" "There's no rush, Hannah. You and Caleb can stay here as long as you need." "I know, and I'm grateful," I said, "but I need to start building a life for us. I can't hide forever." As if on cue, Dad walked in, newspaper tucked under his arm. "I might have something for you," he said, pulling out a folded section. "The community center's looking for a part-time administrative assistant. It's not much, but it's a start." I scanned the ad, hope looming in my chest. "This is perfect. Thank you, Dad." The next few days were a whirlwind of activity. I polished my resume, bought a secondhand suit from a thrift store, and practiced interview questions with Mom. All the while, I kept one eye on my phone, half expecting it to explode with angry messages from Eli. But there was nothing. The silence was almost more unnerving than his rage would have been. The morning of my interview, I stood in front of the mirror, barely recognizing the woman staring back at me. Gone was the meek housewife Eli had molded. In her place stood someone stronger, more determined. "You've got this," I whispered to my reflection. As I walked into the community center, my confidence wavered. It had been years since I'd worked outside the home. What if I'd forgotten how to be professional? What if they saw right through me? "Hannah Walker?" A kind-faced woman approached, hand outstretched. "I'm Sandra, the center director. Thank you for coming in." The interview flew by in a blur of questions and answers. To my surprise, I found myself speaking passionately about my desire to contribute to the community and build a better future for my son. "Well, Hannah," Sandra said as we wrapped up, "I think you'd be a great fit here. When can you start?" I blinked, stunned. "Really? I mean, I can start anytime. Thank you so much. As I left the building, my phone buzzed. My heart leapt to my throat when I saw Eli's name on the screen. Where the hell are you? His voice was cold, controlled. I've been calling for days. I took a deep breath, steeling myself. I'm not coming back, Eli. Caleb and I are safe, and that's all you need to know. You can't do this, he hissed. I'll find you. I'll dash. I hung up, my hand shaking but my resolve firm. Quickly, I dialed Dad's number. It's done, I said when he answered. He knows we're gone. Dad's voice was grave. All right, I'll call the lawyer. We'll file for divorce and a restraining order first thing tomorrow. That night, as I tucked Caleb into bed, he looked up at me with wide, innocent eyes. Mommy, when are we going home? My heart clenched, but I managed to smile. We're home, sweetheart. This is our new adventure, remember? He nodded solemnly. I like it here. Grandma makes good cookies. I laughed, feeling a weight lift from my shoulders. She sure does.
And you know what?
Mommy got a new job today. Things are going to get even better, I promise. As I closed Caleb's door, I heard Mom and Dad talking in hushed tones downstairs. The road ahead would be challenging, but for the first time in years, I felt truly alive. Eli had underestimated me, thinking I'd crumble without him. But he'd forgotten one crucial thing. A mother's love is the most powerful force in the world. And I was just getting started. The doorbell's chime cut through the peaceful Saturday morning, startling me from my coffee-induced reverie. I exchanged a worried glance with Mom before approaching the door cautiously. My heart nearly stopped when I saw who was standing on the porch. Abigail, Eli's sister, stood there, her usually immaculate appearance slightly disheveled. Her eyes were red-rimmed, and she clutched her purse like a lifeline. Hannah, she said, her voice barely above a whisper. Can we talk? I hesitated, torn between slamming the door and hearing her out. Curiosity won. 5 minutes, I said, stepping aside to let her in. We sat in the living room, an uncomfortable silence stretching between us. Abigail fidgeted with her wedding ring, avoiding my gaze. Eli sent you, didn't he? I finally asked, breaking the tension. Abigail's head snapped up. Yes.
No.
It's complicated. She took a deep breath. I came to talk some sense into you, to convince you to go back. But now that I'm here, I'm not so sure anymore. I leaned forward, intrigued. What do you mean? Eli's not doing well, Hannah, Abigail confessed. He's drinking more, lashing out at work. I've never seen him like this. A part of me felt a twisted satisfaction at Eli's struggles, but I quickly pushed that feeling aside. I'm sorry to hear that, but it's not my problem anymore. Abigail nodded, her eyes filling with tears.
I know.
And I'm starting to understand why you left. The things he said, the way he's been acting, it's like I don't even know my own brother anymore. As Abigail spoke, I felt a shift in the air between us. The animosity I'd expected melted away, replaced by a tentative understanding. He's always been arrogant, Abigail continued, but lately, it's like he's spiraling. His boss called me yesterday, warning that if Eli doesn't shape up, he might lose his job. I absorbed this information, my mind racing. Eli losing his job could complicate things, especially when it came to child support for Caleb. Why are you telling me all this? I asked, genuinely curious. Abigail met my gaze, her expression a mix of guilt and determination. Because I was wrong about you, Hannah. I've always seen you as the problem in Eli's life, but now I realize it's the other way around. And I want to help. I sat back, stunned. Help?
How?
I know things about Eli's business dealings, Abigail said, lowering her voice. Things that could be useful if he tries to fight you for custody or refuses to pay support. My heart raced at the implications of her words. Are you sure about this? He's your brother. Abigail nodded firmly. I'm sure. It's time someone stood up to him, and I think you're the one to do it. As we talked, Abigail shared details about Eli's work life, his financial situation, and the growing discontent among his colleagues. Each revelation felt like a piece of armor, strengthening my resolve. When Abigail finally left, promising to keep in touch, I felt a strange mix of emotions. Relief at having an unexpected ally, guilt for the satisfaction I felt at Eli's struggles, and a renewed determination to build a better life for Caleb and myself. Mom appeared in the doorway, concern etched on her face. "Everything okay, sweetheart?" I nodded, a small smile tugging at my lips. "Yeah, I think it is. Things are changing, Mom. And for once, it feels like they're changing in our favor." That night, as I tucked Caleb into bed, he asked about his father for the first time since we'd left. "When will Daddy come see me?" My heart clenched, but I kept my voice steady. "I'm not sure, sweetie. But you know what? You and I are going to have so many adventures together. You won't even notice." As I closed Caleb's door, I felt a surge of determination. Eli had underestimated me, thinking I'd crumble without him. But with my family's support and now Abigail's unexpected alliance, I was stronger than ever. Tomorrow, I call my lawyer. It was time to take control of our future, once and for all. Eli's reign of emotional tyranny was over, and a new chapter was beginning, one where I held the pen. The sharp knock on the door sent a jolt through me. I knew who it was before I even reached for the handle. Taking a deep breath, I steeled myself and opened the door. Eli stood there, his once immaculate appearance now disheveled. His eyes, bloodshot and wild, bore into mine with a mixture of anger and desperation. "Where's my son?" he demanded, pushing past me into the house. I closed the door, my heart racing but my voice steady. "Caleb's at school, Eli. What are you doing here?" He whirled around, his face contorted with rage. "What am I doing here? You took my son and disappeared. I'm here to take you both home." "This is our home now," I said, surprised by the calmness in my voice. "Caleb and I aren't going anywhere with you." Eli's laugh was bitter, bordering on hysterical. "You can't do this, Hannah. You're nothing without me. How do you expect to survive?" I felt a surge of anger, but also pity. This man, once so powerful in my eyes, now seemed small and pathetic. "I'm doing just fine, Eli. I have a job, a support system, and most importantly, I have my self-respect back." His eyes narrowed. "A job? Don't make me laugh. What could you possibly do?" I straightened my shoulders, meeting his gaze. "I'm an administrative assistant at the community center. It's not glamorous, but it's honest work, and I'm good at it." Eli scoffed, but I saw a flicker of uncertainty in his eyes. "You'll come crawling back when the money runs out. You always do." "Not this time," I said, my voice gaining strength. "I've learned a lot about you, Eli. About your work, your finances. Abigail's been quite informative." The color drained from his face. "Abigail?
What are you talking about?"
I took a step closer, emboldened by his reaction. "I know about the creative accounting, Eli. The offshore accounts. How long before your bosses figure it out?" Eli's composure cracked. He lunged forward, grabbing my arm. "You don't know what you're talking about. Let go of me," I said, my voice low and dangerous. "Or I'll call the police and tell them everything." He released me as if burned, stumbling backward. "You wouldn't dare." "Try me," I challenged. "I'm not the same woman you married, Eli. I won't be bullied or manipulated anymore." For a moment, we stood in silence, the air thick with tension. Then, something in Eli seemed to deflate. He sank onto the couch, head in his hands. "What happened to us, Hannah?" he asked, his voice barely above a whisper. I felt a twinge of sympathy, but I pushed it aside. "You happened, Eli. Your arrogance, your selfishness. You forgot that a marriage, a family, is about more than just you." He looked up, his eyes red-rimmed. "I can change. We can start over." I shook my head. "It's too late for that. I've moved on, and so has Caleb. We're happy here." "You can't keep my son from me," Eli said, a hint of his old anger returning. "I'm not," I replied. "You can see Caleb, but it'll be on our terms. Supervised visits, until you prove you can be the father he deserves." Eli stood, his shoulders slumped in defeat. "This isn't over, Hannah." As he reached for the door, I called out, "You're right, Eli. It's not over. It's just beginning for me and Caleb. The door closed behind him, and I let out a shaky breath. I'd done it. I'd stood up to Eli, asserted my independence, and come out stronger. I walked to the window, watching Eli's car disappear down the street. A weight I hadn't even realized I'd been carrying lifted from my shoulders. For the first time in years, I felt truly free. My phone buzzed with a text from the school, a reminder about Caleb's upcoming parent-teacher conference. I smiled, realizing I had a life to get back to, a good life that I'd built for myself and my son. As I turned away from the window, I caught my reflection in the mirror. The woman staring back at me was stronger, more confident, and ready to face whatever challenges lay ahead. Eli's visit hadn't broken me. It had only reinforced my resolve. The future was ours to shape, and I couldn't wait to see what it held. The shrill ring of my phone cut through the peaceful morning. Abigail's name flashed on the screen, her voice urgent when I answered. "Hannah, you need to turn on the news. Now." I fumbled for the remote, my heart racing as I flipped to the local channel. The headline made my breath catch. Corporate scandal rocks Eli Walker's company. The reporter's voice filled the room. In a shocking turn of events, Eli Walker, former rising star at Pinnacle Enterprises, has been fired amidst allegations of financial misconduct and embezzlement. I sank onto the couch, my mind reeling. Despite everything, a part of me ached for the man I once loved. "Hannah, are you there?" Abigail's voice crackled through the phone. "Yes, I managed."
I
can't believe it. "It's bad, Hannah. Really bad. The SEC is involved. Eli's facing possible criminal charges." As the reality sank in, a strange mix of emotions washed over me. Vindication, pity, and an overwhelming sense of relief. The man who had once loomed so large in my life was crumbling, his carefully constructed facade finally giving way. "What happens now?" I asked, more to myself than Abigail. "I don't know," she replied softly. "But I thought you should hear it from me first." After hanging up, I sat in stunned silence, the TV still blaring in the background. The doorbell jolted me back to reality. I opened it to find my father, his face a mask of concern. "I saw the news," he said, pulling me into a hug. "Are you okay?" I nodded against his shoulder, surprised to find tears in my eyes. "I'm fine, Dad. It's just a lot to process." We sat at the kitchen table, cups of coffee growing cold between us. Dad's voice was gentle when he spoke. "You know this doesn't change anything, right? You're still better off without him." "I know," I said, meeting his gaze. "It's just hard to see someone fall so far, even if they deserve it." As the days passed, more details of Eli's downfall emerged. The arrogance that had driven me away had finally caught up with him at work. Colleagues spoke of his increasingly erratic behavior, his refusal to listen to advice, his reckless decisions that had cost the company millions. Meanwhile, my own life continued to flourish. My work at the community center had expanded, and I'd been offered a promotion to program coordinator. Caleb was thriving in his new school, making friends and excelling in his studies. One evening, as I tucked Caleb into bed, he asked the question I'd been dreading. "Mommy, why is everyone talking about Daddy on TV?" I sat on the edge of his bed, choosing my words carefully. "Your daddy made some mistakes at work, sweetheart. He's in trouble now, but that doesn't change how much he loves you." Caleb's brow furrowed. "Will we see him soon?" "I'm not sure," I answered honestly. "But I promise, no matter what happens, you and I will be okay." As I closed Caleb's door, my phone buzzed with a text from Eli. "Can we talk? Please." I stared at the screen, my finger hovering over the reply button. Part of me wanted to ignore it, to let him face the consequences of his actions alone. But another part, the part that remembered the man I'd once loved, couldn't turn away completely. I typed a brief response. "Tomorrow. Coffee shop on Main. 2 p.m. As I hit send, I felt a weight lift from my shoulders. Whatever happened tomorrow, I knew I was strong enough to face it. Eli's downfall hadn't broken me. It had only reinforced the strength I'd found within myself. I walked to the window, looking out at the quiet street. The future stretched before me, uncertain but full of possibility. For the first time in years, I felt truly free to shape my own destiny. Eli's twist of fate had become my opportunity for a new beginning, and I was ready to embrace it with open arms. The autumn breeze rustled through the leaves as I walked Caleb to his first day of kindergarten. His little hand clutched mine tightly, a mix of excitement and nervousness radiating from him. "You're going to do great, sweetheart," I reassured him, kneeling to straighten his backpack. Caleb's eyes darted around the schoolyard, then fixed on something behind me. His face lit up. "Daddy." I turned, my heart skipping a beat as I saw Eli approaching. He looked different, humbled, the arrogance gone from his stance. His eyes met mine, a silent question in them. I nodded, giving him permission to join us. "Hey, champ," Eli said, his voice thick with emotion as he knelt beside Caleb. "Ready for your big day?" As Caleb chattered excitedly about his new school supplies, I watched Eli's face. The man before me was a far cry from the domineering husband I'd left. The past year had changed us both. After dropping Caleb off, Eli and I walked in awkward silence towards the coffee shop on the corner. "Thank you," Eli said finally, "for letting me be here today." I nodded, choosing my words carefully. "Caleb needs both of us, Eli. As long as you're committed to being a good father, I won't stand in your way." Eli's shoulders sagged with relief. "I've been going to therapy," he confessed, trying to understand why I became who I was. "I'm sorry, Hannah, for everything." The words I'd once longed to hear now washed over me without the impact I'd imagined. I realized I no longer needed his apology to move forward. "I appreciate that, Eli. I hope you find peace." We reached the coffee shop, and I checked my watch. "I need to get to work. I have a big presentation today." Eli's eyebrows raised. "The community center?" I smiled, a hint of pride in my voice. "Actually, I've been promoted to program director for the entire county. We're launching a new initiative for underprivileged youth." Surprise and admiration flickered across Eli's face. "That's incredible, Hannah. You've really found your calling." As we parted ways, I felt a sense of closure settling over me. The anger and hurt that had driven me for so long had faded, replaced by a quiet strength and self-assurance. That evening, as Caleb regaled me with stories from his first day, my phone buzzed with a text from Mom. "Dinner tomorrow night to celebrate your presentation? Dad's grilling steaks." I smiled, typing back a quick, "Wouldn't miss it." After tucking Caleb in, I stood in front of the mirror in my bedroom. The woman staring back at me was a far cry from the timid housewife I'd been a year ago. My eyes were clear, my stance confident. I'd not only survived, but thrived. I thought about the journey that had brought me here, the pain, the fear, the moments of doubt, but also the triumph, the self-discovery, and the unwavering support of my family and friends. Eli's downfall had been a catalyst, but my rise had been entirely my own doing. I'd rebuilt my life brick by brick, creating a foundation of self-worth and independence that could weather any storm. As I climbed into bed, I felt a profound sense of peace wash over me. The future stretched out before me, full of possibilities. I had a career I was passionate about, a son I adored, and a support system that had proven unshakable. Eli would always be a part of our lives, but no longer as the domineering force he once was. We'd found a new balance, one that put Caleb's well-being first and allowed us both to grow. I closed my eyes, a small smile playing on my lips. Tomorrow was a new day, full of promise and potential. And for the first time in years, I was excited to see what it would bring. The journey hadn't been easy, but it had been worth every step. I discovered a strength within myself that I never knew existed, and I was ready to face whatever challenges lay ahead. As sleep began to claim me, one final thought drifted through my mind. I was no longer defined by my past or by Eli's actions. I was Hannah, mother, career woman, survivor. And my story was just beginning.
The chime of a text message shattered the illusion of our perfect family portrait. I glanced at Peter, his face illuminated by the glow of his phone screen, a fleeting smile playing on his lips. My husband of 15 years, the father of our son, and the man I thought I knew better than anyone else in the world. "Everything okay, honey?" I asked, trying to keep my voice light. Peter's head snapped up, his eyes meeting mine for a brief second, before darting away. Just work stuff, Lily. Nothing to worry about, I nodded, turning my attention back to our son, Jack, who was busy regaling his cousins with tales of his latest soccer triumph. The annual family gathering buzzed around us, a cacophony of laughter and chatter that usually filled me with warmth. But now, an icy tendril of doubt had wormed its way into my heart. Mom, did you see that goal I scored? Jack's excited voice cut through my thoughts. I plastered on a smile. Of course, sweetie, you were amazing out there. As Jack launched into another animated description, I couldn't help but steal glances at Peter. He was engrossed in his phone again, thumbs flying across the screen. Who was he texting with such urgency at a family event? Earth to Lily. My sister Sarah's voice startled me. You okay? You look like you've seen a ghost. I forced a laugh. Just tired, I guess. It's been a long week. Sarah raised an eyebrow. Uh-huh. And I'm the Queen of England. Spill it, sis. Before I could respond, Peter stood up abruptly. I need to make a quick call. Work emergency. As he walked away, his phone slipped from his pocket, landing face up on the grass. The screen lit up with a new message, and my heart stopped. Can't wait to see you tomorrow, handsome. Missing you already. Gina, I snatched up the phone, my hands trembling. Who the hell was Gina? Lily? Sarah's concerned voice seemed to come from far away. What's wrong? I shook my head, unable to form words. The perfect picture of our life together was crumbling before my eyes, and I didn't know how to stop it. Peter returned, his brow furrowing when he saw his phone in my hand. Everything okay, hon? I met his gaze, searching for any sign of guilt or remorse. But all I saw was confusion and a hint of annoyance. Who's Gina? The words tumbled out before I could stop them. Peter's face paled for a split second before he recovered. Oh, she's a new client at work. We have a big presentation tomorrow. Really? I held up the phone, my voice trembling. Because this message doesn't sound very professional to me. The air around us seemed to freeze. I was vaguely aware of Sarah ushering Jack and the other kids away, giving us some privacy. Peter's jaw clenched. Lily, can we not do this here? Let's talk about this at home. I laughed bitterly. Talk about what, Peter? How you're cheating on me? How our entire marriage is a lie. Keep your voice down, he hissed, glancing around nervously. You're making a scene. I'm making a scene? I couldn't believe what I was hearing. You're the one who's been sneaking around behind my back. Peter grabbed my arm, pulling me away from the curious glances of our family members. Lily, please. I can explain everything, just not here, not now. I yanked my arm free, tears stinging my eyes. Fine, but don't think for a second that this conversation is over. As I walked away, my mind reeling from the shock of discovery, I caught sight of Jack watching us with wide, worried eyes. In that moment, I knew that whatever happened next, I had to be strong. For him, for myself, and for the life I thought we had. The perfect picture was shattered, but I was determined to pick up the pieces and create something new, with or without Peter. The days following the family gathering blurred together in a haze of suspicion and doubt. I found myself scrutinizing Peter's every move, searching for clues I might have missed before. But he carried on as if nothing had changed, his easy smile and casual affection a stark contrast to the turmoil churning inside me. One morning, as I packed Jack's lunch for school, Peter breezed into the kitchen, adjusting his tie. I might be late tonight, he said, grabbing a piece of toast. Big presentation with a new client. I froze, the peanut butter knife hovering over the bread. Is it Gina? The name felt like poison on my tongue. Peter's eyes flickered with something, guilt, annoyance, before he laughed it off. No, not Gina, different client. Why do you ask? I shrugged, trying to keep my voice steady. Just curious. He kissed my cheek. The familiar scent of his cologne now tinged with deceit. Don't wait up, okay? As soon as the front door closed behind him, I slumped against the counter, fighting back tears. How had we come to this? When had the man I loved become a stranger? Mom? Jack's voice startled me. Are you okay? I plastered on a smile, determined not to let my son see my pain. Of course, sweetie. Just tired. Ready for school? As we drove to Jack's school, I tried to focus on his chatter about his upcoming science project, but my mind kept drifting back to Peter and his secrets. Oh, Mom! Jack exclaimed suddenly. I forgot to tell you. Dad's work partner came over yesterday when you were at the grocery store. My hands tightened on the steering wheel. Work partner? Jack nodded enthusiastically. Yeah, her name's Gina. She's really nice. She helped me with my math homework. The world tilted on its axis. Gina had been in our house with my son. The betrayal cut deeper than I could have imagined. That's great, honey. I managed to choke out as we pulled up to the school. Have a good day, okay? As soon as Jack was out of sight, I let the tears fall. How dare Peter bring that woman into our home? How dare he involve our son in his deception? I spent the day in a fog, mechanically going through the motions of housework while my mind raced. By the time I heard Peter's key in the lock that night, I was seething with a mix of anger and hurt. Hey, beautiful, he called out, his voice light and carefree. Sorry I'm late. The presentation went great. I met him in the hallway, arms crossed. I'm sure it did. Was Gina there? Peter's smile faltered. Lily, not this again. I told you she's just a colleague. A colleague who comes to our house when I'm not here, I shot back. Who helps our son with his homework? The color drained from Peter's face. Jack told you about that? He did. What I want to know is why you didn't. Peter ran a hand through his hair, sighing heavily. I didn't think it was a big deal. She was in the neighborhood, stopped by to drop off some files. Stop lying to me, I exploded, years of trust crumbling in an instant. I saw the message, Peter. I know there's something going on between you two. For a moment, silence hung heavy between us. Then Peter's shoulders sagged, defeat written across his features. Lily, I don't know what to say. It's not what you think, but... But what? I pressed, my heart pounding. Tell me the truth, Peter. For once in your life, just be honest with me. He met my gaze, and in that moment, I saw a flicker of the man I'd fallen in love with all those years ago. I'm sorry, he whispered. I never meant for any of this to happen. As the weight of his unspoken confession settled over us, I realized that our perfect life had been built on a foundation of sand. And now, as the tide of truth rushed in, everything we'd known was about to be washed away. The clock on the nightstand glowed an accusatory 2:37 a.m. as I lay wide awake, Peter's soft snores a mocking reminder of his apparent peace of mind. I couldn't take it anymore. I sat up abruptly, flicking on the bedside lamp. Peter, wake up, we need to talk. He stirred, blinking in confusion. Lily, what's wrong? What's wrong? I laughed bitterly. Everything's wrong, Peter, and we're going to hash this out right now. Fully awake now, Peter propped himself up against the headboard. Okay, let's talk. I took a deep breath, steeling myself. Are you having an affair with Gina? No. The denial came quickly, almost rehearsed. I told you, she's just a colleague. A colleague who sends you flirty messages? Who comes to our house when I'm not here? Peter ran a hand through his hair, sighing heavily. It's complicated. Then uncomplicate it for me, I snapped. He was quiet for a long moment, and when he spoke, his voice was low. I'm not having an affair, Lily. But I'd be lying if I said I wasn't attracted to Gina. The admission hit me like a physical blow. And does she feel the same way? Peter nodded slowly. We've talked about it, but nothing's happened, I swear. Nothing's happened, I echoed incredulously. You've been lying to me, sneaking around, bringing her into our home. How is that nothing? I know it looks bad, Peter pleaded, but I never meant for any of this to happen. Gina and I, we just... connected. In a way I haven't felt in a long time. His words cut deep, each one a knife to my heart. And what about our connection, Peter? What about our marriage, our family? I love you, Lily. I love our life together, but lately it's felt, I don't know, stagnant? I recoiled as if he'd slapped me. Stagnant? Is that how you see our life, our love? Peter reached for my hand, but I pulled away. That's not what I meant. It's just, Gina makes me feel alive again, excited about life, about work. And I don't? My voice cracked. Am I just the boring housewife now? No, of course not, Peter insisted. You're an amazing mother, a wonderful wife. It's not about you, it's... Don't you dare say it's not about me, I interrupted, fury rising. This affects me. It affects Jack. Your choices impact all of us. Peter fell silent, his face a mask of guilt and confusion. So what now? I asked, my anger giving way to exhaustion. Where do we go from here? He shrugged helplessly. I don't know. I love you, Lily. I don't want to lose our family, but I can't deny my feelings for Gina either. In that moment, something inside me snapped, the last thread of hope I'd been clinging to disintegrated. Well, you can't have both, I said, my voice eerily calm. You need to make a choice, Peter, right now. He stared at me, panic flickering in his eyes. Lily, please. Can't we talk about this more? Maybe see a counselor? I shook my head, a strange sense of clarity washing over me. No, Peter, I'm done talking. I'm done being your second choice, your safe option. I deserve better than that. Jack deserves better than that. What are you saying? Peter's voice was barely a whisper. I'm saying that if you can't commit to our marriage, to our family 100%, then I'm out. No more lies, no more Gina, no more excuses. The silence that followed was deafening. I watched Peter's face, searching for any sign of the man I'd fallen in love with, the father of my child, but all I saw was a stranger, torn between his comfortable life and his exciting new prospect. In that moment, I knew. Whatever Peter's decision, our life as we knew it was over. It was time for me to reclaim my identity, to create a secure future for Jack and myself, with or without Peter. As the first light of dawn crept through the curtains, I made my own choice. It was time to start over. The business card felt heavy in my hand as I dialed the number. Hawkins Investigations, a gruff voice answered. Hello, I said, my voice barely above a whisper. I need your help. An hour later, I sat across from Mike Hawkins in a nondescript coffee shop far from our neighborhood. His weathered face remained impassive as I poured out my story. So, Mrs. Thompson, you want evidence of your husband's affair? He asked, scribbling in a small notebook. I nodded, swallowing hard. I need to know the truth, for myself and for my son. Mike leaned back, studying me. It won't be pretty, you know. Are you sure you're ready for what we might find? Was I ready? No, but I had to do this. I'm sure, I said firmly. Over the next week, I lived a double life. To Peter and Jack, I was the same old Lily, making breakfasts, helping with homework, smiling through dinner conversations that now felt like charades. But inside, I was a coiled spring, waiting for Mike's updates. The first photos arrived on a Tuesday. Peter and Gina, leaving a restaurant together, his hand on the small of her back. I stared at the images until they blurred, my tears falling onto the glossy paper. More evidence trickled in, text messages, credit card receipts for hotel rooms, a video of them kissing in a park. Each new piece of information was a dagger to my heart, but it also steeled my resolve. Then came the bombshell. Mike's voice was grim over the phone. Mrs. Thompson, I think you should come to my office. There's something you need to see in person. My hands shook as I drove across town, my mind racing with possibilities. What could be worse than what I'd already seen? Mike's office was cluttered but cozy. He gestured for me to sit, then slid a manila folder across the desk. I'm sorry, he said softly. With trembling fingers, I opened the folder. Inside was a sonogram image. My breath caught in my throat as I read the name at the top, Gina Carlson. She's pregnant? I whispered, the words tasting like ash in my mouth. Mike nodded solemnly. About 10 weeks, according to the date on the image. The room spun around me. Peter wasn't just having an affair, he was starting a whole new family. Our life together, our dreams, our plans for the future. They all crumbled to dust in that moment. Mrs. Thompson, Lily, Mike's voice cut through my spiraling thoughts. I know this is a lot to process, but you need to think about your next steps. Legally, financially? I nodded numbly, my mind already racing ahead. I couldn't stay in that house, pretending everything was fine. I couldn't let Jack grow up in a home built on lies. I need to leave, I said, surprising myself with the strength in my voice. I need to take Jack and start over. Mike nodded approvingly. That's a brave decision. I can recommend a good divorce attorney if you need one. As I drove home, my resolve hardened with each passing mile. The Lily who had given up her career to support Peter's, who had turned a blind eye to his late nights and suspicious texts, that Lily was gone. In her place was a woman ready to fight for herself and her son, a woman who deserved honesty, respect, and love. I pulled into our driveway, staring at the house that no longer felt like home. My hand reached for my phone, fingers hovering over my sister Sarah's number. She had always been my rock, my confidant. If anyone could help me through this, it was her. Taking a deep breath, I pressed call. As the phone rang, I steeled myself for the conversation ahead. It was time to set my plan in motion, time to reclaim my life and secure a future for Jack. A future free from Peter's betrayal and lies. The moment Sarah's voice came through the line, I felt a surge of strength. Sarah, I said, my voice steady and determined, I need your help. It's time for me to leave Peter. The suitcases stood like sentinels by the door, packed with the remnants of my shattered life. Peter's business trip couldn't have come at a better time. 3 days to pack up our lives to disappear before he could sweet-talk me into staying. Mom, why can't I tell Dad where we're going? Jack asked, his young face creased with worry. I knelt beside him, my heart breaking. Sweetie, remember what we talked about? Sometimes grown-ups need time apart to figure things out. We're going on a little adventure, just you and me. Jack nodded, but I could see the confusion in his eyes. I hated lying to him, but how could I explain that his father had betrayed us both? As I zipped up the last bag, my phone buzzed. Sarah's text read, "Everything's ready at my place. You sure about this?" I typed back a quick yes before turning to Jack. "Ready for our adventure, buddy?" We loaded the car in silence, each piece of luggage feeling heavier than the last. As I locked the front door, memories flooded through me. First date kisses on the porch, bringing Jack home from the hospital, countless family dinners and movie nights. How had it all gone so wrong? Back inside, I placed the letter I'd written to Peter on the kitchen counter. My hands shook as I read it one last time. "Peter, by the time you read this, Jack and I will be gone. I know about Gina. I know about the baby. I can't live with your lies anymore. I've initiated divorce proceedings. My lawyer will be in touch. Goodbye, Lily." Short, simple, devastating, just like our marriage had become. As I turned to leave, a framed photo on the mantel caught my eye, our wedding day. We looked so young, so in love, so full of hope for the future. Impulsively, I grabbed it, shoving it into my purse, a reminder of what we'd lost, or perhaps of the strength I'd need to find again. The drive to Sarah's was tense, Jack unusually quiet in the back seat. I kept glancing in the rearview mirror, half expecting to see Peter's car racing after us, but the roads remained clear, our escape undetected. Sarah was waiting on her porch as we pulled up, her face a mix of concern and determination. She hugged me fiercely as soon as I stepped out of the car. "You're doing the right thing, Lil," she whispered. "I'm so proud of you." As we unloaded the car, my phone rang. Peter's name flashed on the screen. I stared at it, my heart pounding. This was it, the moment of truth. "You should answer it," Sarah said gently. "Get it over with." Taking a deep breath, I swiped to accept the call. "Hello? Lily? Where are you?" Peter's voice was frantic. "I came home early to surprise you, but the house is empty. What's going on?" I closed my eyes, steeling myself. "I left, Peter. I know everything, about Gina, about the baby. It's over." "What? Lily? No, please, let me explain." "There's nothing to explain," I cut him off, surprising myself with the steel in my voice. "I won't be your second choice anymore. I deserve better than that, and so does Jack." "Jack, where is he? Let me talk to him." Peter's voice rose, panic setting in. "No," I said firmly. "He's safe with me. My lawyer will be in touch about custody arrangements." "Lawyer? Lily, wait." I ended the call, my whole body shaking. Sarah wrapped an arm around me, leading me inside. Jack looked up from where he was arranging his toys in the guest room, his eyes wide with questions I wasn't ready to answer. As I sank onto the couch, the reality of what I'd done hit me like a tidal wave. I'd left my husband, I'd uprooted my son, I'd thrown our entire lives into chaos. But beneath the fear and uncertainty, a small spark of hope flickered to life. For the first time in years, I felt like I was taking control of my destiny. No more lies, no more pretending. This was my new dawn, and despite the pain, I was ready to embrace it. Sarah pressed a mug of tea into my hands. "What now?" she asked softly. I took a sip, letting the warmth spread through me. "Now," I said, my voice growing stronger, "we fight. For Jack, for our future, for the life we deserve." As the sun set on my old life, I felt a fierce determination rising within me. The road ahead would be hard, but I was ready to face it head on. This was just the beginning of my story of resilience, of rediscovery, of reclaiming the woman I used to be and becoming someone even stronger. The incessant buzzing of my phone jolted me awake. Squinting at the screen, I saw 15 missed calls from Peter. My heart raced as I realized he must have returned home to find us gone. "Lily?" Sarah's concerned voice came from the doorway. "He's been calling nonstop. Maybe you should." The phone erupted again, Peter's name flashing on the screen. With a deep breath, I answered. "Where the hell are you?" Peter's voice was a mixture of anger and panic. "And where's Jack?" "We're safe," I replied. trying to keep my voice steady. That's all you need to know right now. Safe? What are you talking about? I come home to an empty house and a goddamn letter? You can't just take my son and disappear. His words ignited a fury within me. Your son? The one you were ready to replace with Gina's baby? Silence fell on the other end. When Peter spoke again, his voice was low, dangerous. You don't know what you're talking about, Lily. Come home now and we can sort this out. There's nothing to sort out, I said, my resolve strengthening. I know everything, Peter. The affair, the pregnancy, all of it. It's over. Over? He laughed bitterly. You think you can just walk away? I'll fight you on this, Lily. I'll take you to court. You'll what? I interrupted, my voice rising. Tell them how you betrayed your family, how you lied and cheated. Go ahead, Peter. I have all the evidence I need. Another pause. When he spoke again, his tone had changed. Evidence? What are you talking about? I felt a grim satisfaction. Oh, I've been busy while you were playing house with Gina. Every hotel receipt, every text message, every photo. I have it all, so think carefully about your next move. You're bluffing, Peter said, but I could hear the uncertainty in his voice. Am I? Want to risk it? I challenged. I'm done being your doormat, Peter. I'm done pretending everything's fine while you destroy our family. It's time you face the consequences of your actions. Consequences? Peter's voice turned cold. You want to talk about consequences? Fine, I'll see you in court, Lily. And when I'm done, you'll have nothing. No house, no money, and sure as hell, no Jack. The threat sent a chill down my spine, but I refused to let him hear my fear. Bring it on, Peter. I'm not afraid of you anymore. I ended the call, my hands shaking. Sarah rushed to my side, wrapping me in a hug. You did great, Lil. Don't let him intimidate you. But as the adrenaline faded, doubt crept in. Could Peter really take Jack away from me? The thought was unbearable. As if summoned by my fears, Jack appeared in the doorway, his eyes wide with worry. Mom, is everything okay? I heard yelling. I forced a smile, patting the bed beside me. As he curled up next to me, I stroked his hair, trying to find the right words. Jack, honey, there's something we need to talk about. Your dad and I, we're going through some grown-up problems right now. Are you getting divorced? He asked, his voice small. The question hit me like a punch to the gut. Yes, sweetheart. I'm so sorry, but yes, we are. Jack's face crumpled and he buried his head in my shoulder. As I held him, my own tears falling, I realized the true weight of what lay ahead. This wasn't just about me and Peter anymore. It was about Jack and the life he deserved. In that moment, I made a silent vow. No matter what Peter threw at me, no matter how ugly things got, I would fight. For Jack, for our future, for the chance to rebuild our lives free from lies and betrayal. As the sun rose on a new day, I felt a strange mix of fear and determination. The battle ahead would be brutal, but I was ready. Peter had underestimated me for the last time. Now he would learn just how far a mother would go to protect her child and reclaim her dignity. The war had begun, and I intended to win. My heart pounded as I stepped into the elevator of Peter's office building. The manila folder in my hands felt like it weighed a ton, filled with the evidence that would change everything. Sarah's words echoed in my mind. Are you sure about this, Lily? There's no going back. I was sure. It was time to unveil the truth. The conference room fell silent as I walked in, all eyes turning to me. Peter's face drained of color, his mouth opening and closing like a fish out of water. Lily, what are you doing here? He stammered. I ignored him, addressing the room at large. I apologize for the interruption, but there's something you all need to know. Peter's boss, Mr. Jameson, frowned. Mrs. Thompson, we're in the middle of a very important meeting. I'm aware, I cut in, my voice steadier than I felt, but I promise, this is relevant to your company's future. I opened the folder, spreading out photos, receipts, and printed text messages across the conference table. Your star employee, my husband Peter Thompson, has been having an affair with his colleague, Gina Carlson. Gasps filled the room. Peter leapt to his feet. Lily, stop this right now. But I was unstoppable. Not only that, but he's been using company resources to fund their rendezvous, hotel rooms, expensive dinners, all on the company dime. Mr. Jameson's face turned thunderous. Is this true, Thompson? Peter's eyes darted around the room, panic setting in. It's not. I can explain. Just then the door burst open. Gina stood there, her face pale, one hand resting on her slightly swollen belly. I'm sorry, I'm so sorry, she sobbed. I can't do this anymore. The room erupted into chaos. Peter lunged towards Gina, his face contorted with rage. You promised you wouldn't say anything. I stepped between them, my voice ringing out. That's enough, Peter. It's over. All of it. Mr. Jameson's voice cut through the din. Everyone out, except you, Thompson. And you, Mrs. Thompson. We need to talk. As the room cleared, leaving just the three of us, I felt a strange calm settle over me. This was it, the moment of truth. Mr. Jameson's eyes were cold as he addressed Peter. I've known you for years, Thompson. I trusted you, and this is how you repay that trust? Peter's shoulders slumped. Sir, I can explain. Save it, Mr. Jameson snapped. You're fired. Clear out your desk by the end of the day. As Peter stumbled out of the room, Mr. Jameson turned to me. Mrs. Thompson, I'm deeply sorry for what you've been through. Is there anything we can do to help? I took a deep breath. Actually, yes. I used to manage a restaurant before I gave it up to support Peter's career. I'd like to get back into the workforce, but I'll need references. Mr. Jameson nodded, a hint of admiration in his eyes. Consider it done. And Mrs. Thompson, you're a formidable woman. Your husband was a fool to underestimate you. As I left the building, my phone buzzed with a text from Peter. You've ruined everything. I hope you're happy. For a moment, doubt crept in. Had I gone too far? But then I remembered Jack's tearful face, the years of lies and betrayal, and my resolve hardened. I typed back, This isn't about happiness, Peter. It's about justice. For me, for Jack, and for the life you threw away. As I drove to pick up Jack from school, I felt a weight lift from my shoulders. The road ahead would be tough, but for the first time in years, I felt truly free. The war wasn't over. I knew Peter wouldn't go down without a fight. But I had found my strength, my voice, and I was ready for whatever came next. As I pulled up to the school, I saw Jack's face light up when he spotted me. In that moment, I knew that no matter what challenges lay ahead, we would face them together. The future was uncertain, but it was ours to shape. The battle was won, but the journey was just beginning. The courtroom fell silent as the judge cleared his throat. My hands trembled in my lap, and I could feel Peter's icy glare from across the aisle. This was it, the moment that would define our futures. In the matter of Thompson v. Thompson, the judge began, I've reviewed all evidence and testimonies presented. This court finds in favor of Lily Thompson. A collective gasp rippled through the room. I sat, stunned, as the judge continued. Mrs. Thompson is granted primary custody of Jack Thompson, with Mr. Thompson allowed supervised visitation. Furthermore, given the evidence of Mr. Thompson's infidelity and misuse of company funds, Mrs. Thompson is entitled to a substantial portion of their shared assets. Relief washed over me like a tidal wave. We'd done it. Jack was safe, and we had a future. As we left the courthouse, Peter caught up to us, his face a mask of fury and defeat. This isn't over, Lily. You've ruined my life, and I'll make you pay. I stood tall, meeting his gaze. No, Peter, you ruined your own life. I'm just picking up the pieces for Jack and me. With that, I turned away, Jack's hand firmly in mine. As we walked towards our new life, I felt a weight lift from my shoulders. Months passed, and slowly we found our rhythm. I threw myself back into restaurant management, rediscovering the passion I'd set aside for Peter's career. Jack thrived in his new school, making friends and excelling in his studies. One evening, as we sat on our small apartment's balcony, Jack looked up at me. Mom, are you happy now? The question caught me off guard. I thought about the struggles we'd faced, the tears we'd shed, but also the strength we'd found. You know what, sweetie? I am. Are you? He nodded, a small smile playing on his lips. Yeah, I miss Dad sometimes, but I like seeing you smile again. Tears pricked my eyes as I pulled him close. We'd been through hell, but we'd come out stronger. A week later, I received a call from Gina. My heart raced as I answered. Unsure what to expect. Lily, her voice was soft, hesitant. I wanted to thank you. Thank me? I echoed, confused. For being strong enough to do what I couldn't, she explained. Peter, he's not the man either of us thought he was. I left him, the baby and I were starting over. As I hung up, I felt a final piece of the puzzle fall into place. Peter's web of lies had unraveled completely, leaving him alone with the consequences of his actions. That night, as I tucked Jack into bed, I caught sight of our reflection in the mirror. Gone was the broken, betrayed woman I'd been. In her place stood a survivor, a fighter, a mother who'd moved mountains for her child. Mom? Jack's sleepy voice pulled me from my thoughts. Tell me a story. I smiled, settling beside him. Once upon a time, there was a woman who thought her life was perfect. But then she discovered that sometimes things fall apart, so better things can fall together. As I recounted our journey, weaving it into a tale of triumph over adversity, I realized that this wasn't just Jack's bedtime story. It was our story, a testament to resilience, to the power of love, and to the strength we find when pushed to our limits. The road hadn't been easy, and I knew there would be more challenges ahead. Peter's bitterness, the whispers of gossip, the struggle of single parenthood, they were all part of our new reality. But as I kissed Jack goodnight and stepped out into the quiet of our new home, I felt a sense of peace wash over me. We'd weathered the storm and come out stronger on the other side. This wasn't the happily ever after I'd once dreamed of. It was something better, a hard-won victory, a life rebuilt on my own terms. As I gazed out at the city lights, I smiled. The future was uncertain, but for the first time in years, I was excited to face it. Because now, I knew the truth. I was stronger than any challenge life could throw my way. And that knowledge, that was worth everything we'd been through. You lying, cheating bastard! The words burned in my throat as I stared at the damning photos spread across our kitchen table. My husband Zach embracing my own sister Erin, the two people I trusted most in this world, entangled in a sordid affair. My hands shook as I flipped through image after image, each one a dagger to my heart. Zach's strong arms wrapped around Erin's slender waist, her hands caressing his face, staring into his eyes with undisguised lust, and the worst one, their lips locked in a passionate kiss, brazenly out in public without a care. I wanted to scream, to rage, to tear the photos to shreds, but I could only stand there, frozen, as the magnitude of their betrayal crashed over me in icy waves. 10 years, a decade of marriage, of love, of building a life together, did it mean nothing to him? And Erin, my baby sister, how could she do this to me? I practically raised her after Mom went back to work. She was my best friend, my confidant. I trusted her with everything. Bile rose in my throat as my mind raced, trying to process this nightmare. When did it start? All those late nights Zach was working. The weekends Erin would visit friends. God, how far back did this go? Have they been laughing at me this whole time? The naive, trusting fool? The front door slammed and I heard Zach whistling as he walked in, so carefree, so unburdened. Oblivious to the bomb about to detonate our sham of a marriage. Lana? You home, babe? He called out from the foyer. Babe. The casual endearment made me want to vomit. I opened my mouth but no sound came out. My throat choked with anguish and rage. His footsteps approached the kitchen and he sauntered in, his eyes widening as he took in my rigid stance and the photos littering the table. Lana, I can explain, he started, but I cut him off. Explain? Explain what? I hissed, my voice shaking. That you've been screwing my sister? That you two have been carrying on an affair behind my back? Zach at least had the decency to blanch, his face draining of color. It's not what it looks like. Spare me the cliches, I spat. I'm not an idiot, Zach. The pictures don't lie, even if you clearly do. He ran a hand over his face. Lana, please, just let me. How long? I demanded. How long have you been cheating on me with Erin? He looked away, jaw clenched. The silence stretched between us, taut and suffocating. How long, Zach? I shouted, slamming my hand on the table. 6 months, he said quietly. It's been going on for 6 months. 6 months. Half a year of deceit, of betrayal. I felt like I'd been punched in the gut, the wind knocked out of me. My knees buckled and I gripped the table edge for support. I never meant to hurt you, Zach said, taking a step towards me. We never planned this, it just happened. Don't, I choked out, holding up a hand. Don't you dare try to justify this. Tears blurred my vision as the pain overwhelmed me. My husband, my sister, the two people I loved most had ripped my heart to shreds. They'd destroyed everything I held dear. In that moment, as I drowned in anguish and disbelief, one thought crystallized in my mind with blinding clarity. They would pay for this. Somehow, some way, I would make them suffer as deeply as I did now. This wasn't over. It was only the beginning. I walked into my parents' lavish living room, my heart pounding against my ribcage. Zach and Erin were already there, sitting together on the love seat, their hands intertwined. The sight made my stomach churn. My parents sat across from them. their faces etched with concern. They had no idea the bombshell about to be dropped. "Lana, honey, what's this all about?" Mom asked, her brow furrowed. "Aaron said you had something important to discuss with all of us." I laughed bitterly. "Oh, I bet she did. Probably couldn't wait to gloat." Aaron had the audacity to look confused. "Gloat? Lana, what are you talking about?" I threw the stack of photos on the coffee table. They fanned out, displaying in lurid detail the extent of Zack and Aaron's betrayal. Mom gasped, her hand flying to her mouth. Dad leaned forward, his face reddening as he flipped through the images. "Someone want to explain this?" I asked, my voice shaking with barely contained rage. Zack and Aaron exchanged a glance, a silent communication passing between them. Then Aaron turned to our parents, her eyes wide and tearful. "Mom, Dad, I'm so sorry you had to find out this way," she said, her voice trembling. "But Zack and I, we're in love." I stared at her, aghast. The sheer nerve, the utter lack of remorse. "In love," I repeated incredulously. "He's my husband, Aaron, your brother-in-law. How could you do this to me?" Aaron had the gall to look sympathetic. "Lana, I never meant to hurt you, but the heart wants what it wants. Surely you can understand that." "Understand?" I shouted. "You're my sister. I trusted you." Zack cleared his throat. "Lana, please, let's be adults about this. Aaron and I didn't plan this, but we can't deny our feelings." I rounded on him, seething. "Shut up, you lying, cheating scumbag. You don't get to lecture me on being an adult." "Lana, language," Mom admonished, finally finding her voice. "I know you're upset, but that's no way to speak to your husband." I gaped at her. "Are you serious right now? He's been screwing Aaron for months, and you're worried about my language?" Dad held up a hand. "Enough. This is a lot to take in." He turned to Zack and Aaron, his expression stern. "You two have put us in a very difficult position." "We never meant to cause any trouble," Aaron said, all wounded innocence. "But Zack and I, we want to be together. We were hoping for your blessing." I couldn't believe what I was hearing. "Blessing? You want our parents' blessing to continue your sordid little affair?" Mom reached out, placing a hand on my arm. "Lana, honey, I know this is painful, but if Zack and Aaron have found love together, maybe it's for the best. These things happen." I yanked my arm away, staring at her in disbelief. "Are you actually defending them? Choosing their side?" "We're not choosing sides," Dad said placatingly. "But your mother has a point. If their feelings are genuine, who are we to stand in the way?" I looked around the room at the faces of my family and saw nothing but pity and condescension. They actually bought Aaron's act, her crocodile tears and pretty lies. "I can't believe this," I said, my voice hollow. "My own family siding with the people who betrayed me." Aaron stood, moving towards me with outstretched arms. "Lana, please, let's not fight. We're sisters. We can get through this." I recoiled from her touch. "Don't. You're dead to me, both of you." I turned on my heel and stormed out, hot tears stinging my eyes. I heard my mother calling after me, but I didn't stop. Didn't look back. They had made their choice, chosen Zack and Aaron's love over my devastation. My own flesh and blood, so easily manipulated by a few well-placed tears and hollow justifications. But this wasn't over. Not by a long shot. They thought they could just cast me aside, leave me broken and alone while they played happy families. They had no idea what I was capable of. The depths I would sink to make them pay. They wanted to cut me out. Make me the villain in their sordid little drama? Fine, I would show them what a real villain looked like. The silence in my apartment was deafening, broken only by the occasional hum of the refrigerator. I sat at the kitchen table, staring blankly at the wall, a half-empty bottle of whiskey, my only companion. It had been a week since my world imploded, a week since I'd walked out of my parents' house, disowned and betrayed. They'd made their choice, and it wasn't me. My phone buzzed, jolting me out of my daze. I glanced at the screen, seeing a text from my best friend, Sarah. "Lana, I'm so sorry. I just heard about Zack and Aaron. Are you okay? Do you need anything?" I let out a humorless laugh. Okay? I was the furthest thing from okay. My husband was screwing my sister, my family had taken their side, and I was utterly alone. I tossed the phone aside, ignoring the message. I couldn't deal with anyone's pity or platitudes right now. A sharp knock at the door made me jump. I wasn't expecting anyone. For a brief, foolish moment, I thought maybe it was Zack, coming to beg for forgiveness. I yanked open the door, ready to unleash my fury, but it wasn't Zack standing there. It was a man in a crisp suit, holding a thick envelope. "Lana Owens?" he asked, his voice professional and detached. I nodded warily. "Yes, that's me." He held out the envelope. "You've been served." I took it with numb fingers, my heart sinking as I realized what it was. Divorce papers. Zach was actually filing for divorce. The man turned and left without another word, leaving me standing there, clutching the envelope like a lifeline. I stumbled back inside, ripping open the papers with shaking hands. There it was, in cold, legal terms. Zach was petitioning for a no-fault divorce, citing irreconcilable differences. He wanted to split our assets evenly and move on with his life. With Aaron. Rage boiled up inside me, hot and all-consuming. How dare he? How dare he try to just walk away, like our 10 years together meant nothing? I grabbed my phone, dialing Zach's number with furious jabs. It rang once, twice, twap, before clicking over to voicemail. "You coward!" I screamed into the phone. "You think you can just serve me with divorce papers and wash your hands of me? You think you can just run off with my sister and live happily ever after?" I was pacing now, my voice rising with each word. "You destroyed our marriage, our life together. You betrayed me in the worst possible way, and now you want to just walk away like it never happened?" I let out a harsh, bitter laugh. "Well, think again, you bastard. You're not getting rid of me that easily. I won't let you just toss me aside like garbage." I ended the call, throwing the phone onto the couch. My chest heaved with the force of my anger, my hands clenched into fists at my sides. They thought they could just cut me out of their lives, out of the family. They thought they could leave me with nothing while they flaunted their affair, their love. But they had no idea who they were dealing with. I wasn't some weak, pathetic victim who would just roll over and accept their scraps. No, I was Lana Owens, and I was going to make them pay for what they'd done to me. I glanced at the divorce papers, a cold smile curling my lips. They wanted to play dirty? Fine. I could play dirty, too. I picked up my phone again, scrolling through my contacts until I found the one I was looking for. A high-powered divorce attorney, known for his ruthless tactics and take-no-prisoners approach. If Zach and Aaron thought they could just waltz off into the sunset, they had another thing coming. I was going to fight them every step of the way, make their lives a living hell. They had no idea the storm that was coming for them. But they would soon enough. I walked into the dingy diner, the bell above the door announcing my arrival. The place was nearly empty, just a few scattered patrons nursing cups of coffee. I slid into a booth in the back, ignoring the sticky tabletop and torn vinyl seats. Places like this were perfect for clandestine meetings, no one paying any attention to the quiet conversations in shadowy corners. I drummed my fingers on the table, impatient. I checked my watch. He was late. Just as I was about to give up and leave, the door jingled again. A man walked in, his face obscured by a baseball cap pulled low. He scanned the room, his gaze landing on me. He slid into the booth across from me, perhaps his movements furtive. "Lana Owens?" he asked, his voice low. I nodded. "That's me, and you are?" He glanced around as if making sure no one was listening. "Call me John, I hear you're in need of some services." I leaned forward, my voice equally quiet. "I need information. On Zach Andrews and Aaron Owens." John raised an eyebrow. "Your husband and sister, right? The ones who screwed you over?" I gritted my teeth at the blunt reminder. "Yes, them. And what kind of information are we talking about here?" I met his gaze, unflinching. "Anything I can use against them. Dirt, secrets, skeletons in their closets. I want to know everything." John sat back, considering. "That kind of intel doesn't come cheap, you know. It'll take time, resources." I pulled an envelope from my purse and slid it across the table. "That's 10 grand. Consider it a down payment." He picked up the envelope, peeking inside. Satisfied, he tucked it into his jacket. "All right, Mrs. Owens, you've got yourself a deal." We shook hands, sealing our agreement. I felt a thrill of anticipation, knowing I was one step closer to my revenge. As I walked out of the diner, my phone buzzed with an incoming call. It was my divorce attorney, Marcus. "Lana, I've got some news," he said, his voice tinny through the speaker. "Zach's filed a motion to have your assets frozen pending the divorce proceedings." I stopped in my tracks, anger surging through me. "He what?" "He's claiming you're a flight risk, that you'll try to hide money or leave the country." The judge granted the motion. I saw red, my free hand clenching into a fist. "That bastard! He's trying to cut me off. leave me with nothing. Marcus sighed. I'm afraid so. He's playing hardball, Lana. We need to be smart about this. I took a deep breath, forcing myself to think rationally. Okay, okay, we'll fight this. He's not going to get away with it. I'll do my best, but I have to warn you, it's an uphill battle. Zack has some high-powered attorneys on his side. Of course he did. Probably hired the best that his daddy's money could buy, but I wasn't going to let that stop me. Do whatever you have to, Marcus. I'm not going down without a fight. I ended the call, my mind racing. Zack thought he could just freeze me out, leave me destitute and helpless, but he had no idea who he was messing with. I scrolled through my contacts, finding the one I needed. It rang twice before a familiar voice answered. Lana, what's up? Claire, I need a favor, I said, my voice tight. A big one. Claire, my old college roommate turned successful journalist, didn't hesitate, name it. I took a deep breath. I need you to dig up everything you can on Zack, his business dealings, his finances, anything that could be used against him. There was a pause, then, Lena, are you sure about this? It could get messy. I'm sure, I said, steel in my voice. He's trying to ruin me, Claire. I need to fight back with everything I've got. Okay, she said, her tone resolute. I'll see what I can find. I said, but Lana, be careful. Don't let this consume you. I laughed, the sound harsh and bitter. It's too late for that, Claire. This is war, and I intend to win, no matter what it takes. I sat at my computer, my fingers flying over the keys as I composed the email. It was a risk, I knew that, but it was a risk I had to take. I'd spent the last week combing through the information John and Claire had dug up on Zack. Bank statements, business records, emails, a paper trail of deceit and corruption. Zack had been embezzling money from his company for years, funneling it into offshore accounts. He'd been making shady deals, bribing officials, cutting corners, all while presenting himself as a pillar of the community, a loving husband and family man. It made me sick, knowing I'd been married to such a fraud. But it also gave me the ammunition I needed to take him down. I attached the incriminating files to the email, my finger hovering over the send button. This would go to the FBI, the IRS, the media, anyone who could expose Zack's crimes and bring him to justice. But I hesitated. As much as I wanted to see Zack pay for what he'd done, I knew this would also destroy my family. My parents, who had taken his side, who had believed his lies, they would be dragged through the mud right along with him. Was I really willing to do that? To burn down everything, even the innocent bystanders, in my quest for vengeance? A knock at the door startled me out of my thoughts. I minimized the email, my heart pounding. Who could it be at this hour? I crept to the door, peering through the peephole. My stomach dropped. It was Erin. I yanked open the door, glaring at her. What the hell are you doing here? She pushed past me, inviting herself in. We need to talk, Lana. I slammed the door shut. I have nothing to say to you. Erin spun to face me, her expression pleading. Please, just hear me out. I know you're angry, and you have every right to be, but this vendetta, this path you're on, it's not going to end well. I laughed, the sound harsh and bitter. And you care so much about my well-being, right? The sister who stole my husband, who ruined my life. She flinched but stood her ground. I'm not going to apologize for falling in love, Lana. I know it hurts, but sometimes these things just happen. I saw red, my hands clenching into fists. Falling in love? Is that what you call it? Betraying me? Lying to me? Sneaking around behind my back for months? Erin had the audacity to look wounded. It wasn't like that. We never meant to hurt you. But you did, I screamed, the dam finally breaking. You destroyed everything. My marriage, my family, my whole damn life. Tears streamed down my face, hot and angry. Erin reached for me, but I slapped her hand away. Don't you dare touch me, I hissed. You lost that right the second you climbed into bed with my husband. Erin's face hardened, her eyes flashing. Fine, you want to wallow in your bitterness and rage? Go ahead. But I'm warning you, Lana. If you go through with this, if you try to take Zack down, you'll only be hurting yourself in the end. I stepped closer, my voice low and deadly. Is that a threat? She met my gaze unflinchingly. It's a promise. Zack has powerful friends, Lana. People who won't take kindly to you dragging his name through the mud. You have no idea what you're up against. I smiled, cold, cold and vicious. Neither do you, dear sister. Neither do you. I opened the door, gesturing for her to leave. Get out, and don't ever come back here again. Erin shook her head, her expression almost pitying. I hope you know what you're doing, Lana. I really do. She walked out, and I slammed the door behind her, sagging against it. My heart raced, adrenaline pumping through my veins. Erin thought she could intimidate me, scare me off with vague threats and warnings, but she underestimated me. They all did. I straightened, squaring my shoulders. I marched back to my computer, pulling up the email. My finger hovered over the mouse, just a single click away from sending Zack's world crashing down around him. Erin wanted to play hardball? Fine. Game on. I hit send, a grim smile stretching across my face. Let the chips fall where they may. I was all in, no matter the cost. I watched the news with a grim sense of satisfaction, the reporter's words washing over me like a twisted lullaby. Zachary Andrews, prominent businessman and philanthropist, was arrested today on charges of embezzlement, fraud, and bribery. FBI agents raided his office and home early this morning, seizing computers and files as evidence. If convicted, Andrews faces up to 20 years in prison. The screen flashed to footage of Zach being led out of his building in handcuffs, his face a mask of shock and rage. Reporters swarmed around him, shouting questions, but he remained silent, his jaw clenched tight. I smiled, sipping my coffee. It had taken months, but I'd finally done it. I'd brought Zach's house of cards crashing down around him. My phone buzzed with an incoming call. It was my mother. I debated letting it go to voicemail, but some masochistic part of me wanted to hear what she had to say. Hello, I answered, my voice cool and detached. Lana, what have you done? My mother's voice was shrill, panicked. The police are here. They're tearing the house apart. They're saying Erin is involved in Zach's crimes, that she's been embezzling from the family business. I leaned back in my chair, a thrill of vicious pleasure running through me. Well, looks like the golden child isn't so perfect after all. This is your doing, isn't it? You're behind all of this. I examined my nails, my tone bored. I didn't make Erin commit fraud, Mother. She did that all on her own. But you exposed her, exposed all of us. How could you do this to your own family? I laughed, the sound harsh and bitter. My family? The same family that turned their backs on me, that chose Zach and Erin over their own daughter? Spare me the righteous indignation. Lana, please. We can fix this. We can make it right. Just tell the police it was a mistake, that Erin is innocent. I sat up straight, my voice turning to ice. Innocent? She slept with my husband, Mother. She betrayed me in the worst possible way, and you all took her side. We were wrong, okay? Is that what you want to hear? We were wrong, and we're sorry, but this, what you're doing. It's gone too far. I stood, pacing the room like a caged tiger. No, it hasn't gone far enough. Zach and Erin deserve to pay for what they did to me, and if that means burning down everything they care about, so be it. Even if it means destroying this family? Destroying your father's legacy? I stopped, staring out the window. Dad's legacy was a lie, Mother. A shiny veneer covering up the rot underneath. Erin made sure of that. There was a long pause, my mother's ragged breathing echoing down the line. I don't even know who you are anymore, Lana. What happened to my sweet little girl? I closed my eyes, a single tear slipping down my cheek. She died the day her husband and sister ripped her heart out. I'm what's left. I ended the call, tossing the phone aside. I knew I should feel something. Remorse, guilt, regret. But I only felt a grim sense of resolution. Zach and Erin had built their perfect little world on a foundation of lies and betrayal. And I'd made it my mission to expose those lies, to make them face the consequences of their actions. My phone buzzed again, an incoming text from John. It's done. Zach's assets have been seized, his accounts frozen, Erin's being questioned by the FBI as we speak. I smiled, a true, genuine smile. It was really happening. My revenge was complete. I knew there would be fallout, repercussions I couldn't even begin to predict. My family would never forgive me, my own reputation would be tarnished by association. But in that moment, as I watched Zach's mugshot flash across the screen, I couldn't bring myself to care. They had destroyed my life, my future. It was only fair that I returned the favor, an eye for an eye, as they say, and I'd made damn sure they paid their debt in full. I walked into the courtroom, my head held high, my designer suit impeccable. It had been 6 months since Zach's arrest, 6 months of watching his world crumble piece by piece, and today it all came to a head. Zach's sentencing hearing where he would finally face the consequences of his actions. I took my seat in the front row, ignoring the whispers and stares from the packed gallery. I was a pariah now, the vengeful ex-wife who had brought down a pillar of the community. But I didn't care. Let them judge me. They had no idea the hell I'd been through, the betrayal I'd endured. The door at the back of the courtroom opened and Zach was let in, flanked by two bailiffs. He looked haggard, defeated, his once tailored suit hanging off his frame. Our eyes met for a brief moment and I saw a flicker of hatred, of fury. But it was quickly replaced by fear as he took his seat at the defendant's table. The judge entered, a stern-faced woman with steel-gray hair. She looked out over the courtroom, her gaze settling on Zach. Zachary Andrews, you have been found guilty of multiple counts of embezzlement, fraud, and bribery. These are serious crimes, ones that undermine the very fabric of our society. Zach's lawyer stood, clearing his throat. Your Honor, my client deeply regrets his actions and takes full responsibility. He has already made restitution to his victims and is committed to turning his life around. The judge raised an eyebrow. Is that so? Then perhaps you can explain why Mr. Andrews continued to engage in illegal activities even after his arrest, attempting to hide assets and intimidate witnesses? Zach's face paled and he sank lower in his seat. I smiled to myself, remembering the anonymous tip I'd sent to the prosecutor's office. Nothing to say, Mr. Andrews? The judge shook her head. Very well. I hereby sentence you to 15 years in federal prison with the possibility of parole after 10 years served. The gavel banged and it was done. Zach was led away in handcuffs, his face a mask of shock and disbelief. I stood, smoothing my skirt. It was over. I'd won. As I walked out of the courtroom, I was met by a sea of reporters, their cameras flashing, their questions overlapping. Mrs. Owens, how does it feel to see your ex-husband brought to justice? Do you have any comment on the rumors that you were behind the anonymous tips that led to his conviction? What about your sister, Erin? Sources say she's been committed to a psychiatric facility after suffering a breakdown. Do you feel responsible for her condition? I held up a hand, silencing the clamor. I looked directly into the cameras, my voice steady and clear. Zach Andrews is a liar and a cheat who destroyed countless lives with his greed and corruption. I take no pleasure in his downfall, but I do feel a sense of justice being served. I paused, letting my words sink in. As for my sister, Erin made her own choices. She chose to betray me, to lie and scheme and manipulate. Her fate is of her own making. I stepped forward, the reporters parting before me like the Red Sea. I know many of you see me as a villain, a woman scorned who went too far in her quest for revenge, but I assure you, everything I did for the sake of truth and justice. I smiled, cold and brittle. Zach and Erin thought they could destroy me, that they could take everything I loved and walk away unscathed. They were wrong. I walked away, my head held high, my heart empty. I had my revenge, my justice. But at what cost? As I climbed into my waiting car, my phone buzzed with an incoming email. It was from my lawyer, with the subject line, Estate of Paul and Diane Owens. I opened it with shaking fingers, scanning the legalese. My parents had changed their will, leaving the entirety of their fortune to me. I leaned back in my seat, a bitter laugh bubbling up in my throat. I had won, in every sense of the word. But as I stared out the window at the passing city, I couldn't help but wonder, was it worth it? Was any of it worth the price I'd paid, the pieces of myself I'd sacrificed on the altar of vengeance? I closed my eyes, a single tear slipping down my cheek. It was too late for such questions now. The die was cast. The game played out to its inevitable end. I was the last one standing, the queen of the ashes, and that would have to be enough. I stood in the foyer of my parents' mansion, the silence pressing in on me from all sides. The once grand house felt empty, lifeless, a mausoleum to a family long since fractured. It had been a month since the reading of the will, a month since I'd become the sole inheritor of the Owens fortune, a month since I'd lost everything that truly mattered. I walked through the echoing halls, my footsteps muffled by the thick carpets. Portraits of my ancestors lined the walls, their painted eyes seeming to follow me, judging me. I entered my father's study, the room where he'd once held court, dispensing wisdom and discipline in equal measure. Now it was mine, the heavy oak desk bearing the weight of my new responsibilities. I sank into the leather chair, staring out the window at the manicured grounds. I had everything I'd ever wanted, wealth, power, status, but it all felt hollow, meaningless. My phone rang, startling me out of my reverie. I glanced at the screen, seeing an unknown number. I debated letting it go to voicemail, but something compelled me to answer. Hello? My voice sounded strange to my own ears, rusty from disuse. Lana. The voice on the other end was achingly familiar, a ghost from my past. It's me. I sat up straight, my heart pounding. Zach, how did you get this number? A humorless chuckle. Prison has a way of teaching you things, Lana, like how to pull strings, call in favors. I gripped the phone tighter, my knuckles turning white. What do you want, Zach? Haven't you done enough damage? A pause, then a sigh. I wanted to hear your voice. To tell you? I'm sorry. I laughed, the sound harsh and bitter. Sorry? You're sorry? Do you have any idea what you've done to me, to this family? I know. Believe me, I know. His voice was heavy with regret. I was selfish and stupid, and I let my ego get the best of me. But I never meant to hurt you, Lana. I loved you. Tears pricked at my eyes, but I blinked them back. You had a funny way of showing it. I know, and I'll spend the rest of my life paying for my mistakes. But I needed you to know. I never stopped loving you. Even when I was with Aaron, even when I was betraying you, it was always you. I closed my eyes, a single tear slipping down my cheek. It's too late, Zach. Too much has happened, too much has been broken. I know, I needed you to hear it. To know that I'm sorry, that I'd give anything to go back and change what I did. I took a deep breath, steeling myself. Goodbye, Zach. I hope you find peace wherever you end up. I hung up before he could respond, the phone clattering to the desk. I buried my face in my hands, my shoulders shaking with silent sobs. All of this, all the pain and destruction and betrayal, and for what? A hollow victory, an empty fortune, a shattered family. I stood, wiping my eyes. I walked to the window, staring out at the grounds that were now mine, the price of my vengeance, the spoils of my war. But as I looked out at the sprawling estate, I felt a flicker of something I hadn't felt in a long time. Hope. I had a chance now. A chance to start over, to rebuild. To take the broken pieces of my life and fashion them into something new, something better. I wouldn't let Zach and Aaron's betrayal define me, wouldn't let my quest for revenge consume me. I was more than that, stronger than that. I turned away from the window, squaring my shoulders. I had work to do, a legacy to honor, a future to build. I was Lana Owens, the last of my line, the keeper of my family's destiny, and I would not let them down. Not again. Not ever. I took a deep breath and stepped forward, into the unknown, into the rest of my life. It was time to let go of the past, to embrace the future, to find out who I was without the anger, without the pain, to finally, truly live.